welcome to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to follow along, either on the radio later this afternoon or live on Facebook. Please send a quick note. Let us know that you're here. We're working with different mics today because I left my mic on Friday after the funeral, so it was dead. So we've got different mics going on. So if you can't hear me, let Krista know and she'll let me know. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We begin this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our opening hymn is number 165, the green hymnal, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty.
Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace let us pray to the Lord. Have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. This holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God,
Our first reading for this Sunday of the Trinity is found in the first and second chapters of the book of Genesis. At the beginning of time, God the Creator, God the powerful Word, and God the life-giving Spirit formed the earth and all its inhabitants. God sees all this created work as good and then rests on the seventh day. Our reading begins with verse 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while the wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome, and it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on the earth that bear fruit with seed in it. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let there be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth. And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater to rule the day and the lesser to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. Then God said, Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky. So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. Then God said, Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God he created them, male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that creeps upon the earth. God said, See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps upon the earth, everything that has breath and life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that was done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heaven and the earth when they were created. Here ends our first reading. Please join me in reading responsibly Psalm 8. I will read the light-colored print and you respond with the dark. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You whose glory is chanted above the heavens, out of the mouths of infants and children, you have set up a fortress against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have set in their courses, what are mere mortals that you should be mindful of them, and human beings that you should care for them? Yet you have made them little less than divine. With glory and honor you crown them. You have made them rule over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under their feet, all flocks and cattle, and even the wild beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the pathways of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Our second reading for this Sunday of Holy Trinity is found in the second letter to the Church of Corinth, the 13th chapter. Paul closes this challenging letter to the Corinthians with an appeal to Christian fellowship, grounded in the triune harmony of Christ's grace, God's love, and the Spirit's partnership. Our reading begins with verse 11. Paul writes, "Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Here ends the second reading. Please rise for the reading of the Gospel. And join me in the Gospel. Hallelujah. Found in the 28th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. After his resurrection, Jesus summons his remaining disciples and commissions them to baptize and teach all nations in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Our reading begins with verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Now Kristen's going to have a little children's sermon for us.
Yeah. Maybe. It will zoom. Technical difficulties all day.
That's the theme of the day.
Check. Can you see me in the camera? You see me in there?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so today is Holy Trinity Sunday, and the Trinity is one of those things that we as humans cannot fully understand about God, and that's okay. But I'm going to share a little bit of how I just think about the Trinity. So I have a glass of water. What state is this glass of water in? It's okay, liquid. You can answer.
It's liquid.
It's liquid, yeah. Okay, and then I have this really hot one that is steaming on the top. What state is the steam in?
It's a vapor.
Yeah, gas. Yep. How about, this is, I couldn't find any ice in the freezer, so this is a teething toy, but there's ice in it. What state is ice?
That would be solid.
A solid, okay, so we've got liquid, gas, solid. Are they water?
Yeah.
They're still water, right? But they're in three different forms, correct?
Correct.
Steam, ice, water, liquid. That's like God. We have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're still God, but they're in three different forms. So that's just a way to remember that our God is three in one. And just think about the water, that there's gas, liquid, and solid. And you can remember that there's still water, there are just three different forms of it, just like God.
All right, that works.
Hurt my hand though, holding onto the steam one.
Thank you, Kristen.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome to Holy Trinity Sunday, that Sunday that shows up every year where we preachers try our best to preach on the Trinity, the doctrine that states that we believe and confess in a God who is one in three, three in one. And it's that Sunday where all of us preachers also confess that we don't get it, we don't understand it, and it is indeed a mystery. Now, I love mysteries. My bookshelf at home is full of mysteries. My nook is full of mysteries. I like the classics, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Sherlock Holmes. Agatha Christie and Hercule Poirot. I can never say his name. I also like more modern readers like John Sanford and several others. I enjoy digging into a mystery. I enjoy trying to figure it out, and I'm also not above flipping to the end of the book, looking for clues to see if I was right. In many ways, trying to grasp the Trinity, which is the totality of God, is as far beyond our grasp as any good mystery story. It is as far beyond our grasp as that old, old story of the three blind men who try to describe an elephant. Each one of them perceives only a piece of it, so it looks different according to their perspective. So for one, an elephant is long and flexible. For the other, the elephant is large and immovable. And for the third, the elephant is small like a twig. How we perceive the Trinity and how we talk about the Trinity depends in large part on our perspective. All of our lessons for this morning talk about the Trinity, and our Gospel of Matthew contains in it that great conclusion, that great commissioning of the disciples, the laying out of what they are supposed to do, what we are supposed to do, in all of its simple yet very profound glory. If you ever look for instructions on what God would have you do, if you need a roadmap on how to be a disciple, this is it. It gives us a call and it gives us a promise. But it also gives us a headache, because it is one of the few places where the Trinity is explicitly mentioned in Scripture. And so we ask and we ponder, what does it mean to be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? Think about that. We live our entire lives under that benediction, because it begins at baptism when we are marked with the cross of Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit and called to live under the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that benediction carries through for our entire lives. We are reminded of it on Sundays, when our service begins and ends with the same benediction. And we are reminded of it at funeral times, when the last thing the preacher does is pray a prayer of commendation, commending the dear departed to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In that way, the Trinity is the bookend of our existence. So asking, what does this mean, leads us to ponder another deep question. If we live under those bookends of the benediction, if we live under the auspices of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, what does that mean for us on a daily and a weekly basis? Our understanding of both baptism and confession contains just that mystery and just that promise. Living under the benediction, living under the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are daily things. And as we talk about confession and baptism as those things that daily shape how we look at ourselves and the world around us, so too does the Trinity daily shape how we live and and how we look at ourselves and the world around us. We are molded and shaped by this daily understanding of the Trinity, and we are challenged and called by that understanding as well, perhaps even unconsciously. We are led into the mystery and the wonder of God Himself, and we stand in awe of that. Our descriptions and understanding of the Trinity are limited, of course, on this side of heaven. They are a dim mirror, as the Apostle Paul puts it. But nonetheless, we can begin to get a glimpse of things by looking at the pieces that make up the Trinity. For they are indeed the pieces that make up our lives. They are the pieces that make up our discipleship. And they are the pieces that challenge us to see each other in the same light. So we start with God the Creator, so ably laid out for us in the first lesson from Genesis. This is the first person of the Trinity, but he is not alone. This is the one who spun all of creation into existence, the one who chose a people to be witnesses to the world. And the one who looks upon all creation and says, "It is good." Living in the mystery of the Trinity, we can look at all creation. We can look at our neighbors, our brothers and sisters in this community and far, far away, and say to them, "I see in you the reflection of God Himself, and you are good." We have been challenged in recent days to rethink how we perceive our neighbor and how we listen and how we respond. And we are reminded in Genesis that the one who knit our parts together, and indeed all of creation, says as a final word, "You are good." And then there is God the Son, the second person of the Trinity, Redeemer of the world, God in the flesh, who has come into our midst to show us who God is and how to love each other as we have been loved. This too is part of the Trinity, and this too is part of our daily living. The challenge to love. And then there is God the Spirit, whom we have been talking about for the last few weeks, the one who ties this all together, the one who calls and gathers us together and keeps us together with gifts of faith and fruits of the Spirit. Now, having said all this, we have to be mindful and not wander too far off into that ditch that is the ancient heresy of modalism, because you cannot reduce God only to God's constituents. Because all three persons of the Trinity are present in all three parts of the Trinity. God functions in all the expressions mentioned above. But the persons of the Trinity are not limited to only those expressions. Certainly, the fullness of God is expressed and present in each person of the Trinity and in their work. All of us is in a particular role. And so is all of God. But each distinct role is only part of who we are, and each distinct role has a distinct purpose. And this indeed may be part of the reason that we talk of God in this way, because it opens up for us each part, which invites us into the fullness and richness of that which we may not otherwise see if we concentrate only on one aspect of God's personhood. Our gospel for this morning, that Great Commission, calls us to do what we do in the fullness of God. We do not baptize only in the name of God the Creator. We do not baptize only in the name of God the Redeemer. And we do not baptize only in the name of God the Spirit. But we baptize in the entirety of that mystery. And we wander and we live in the entirety of that mystery. We are called to go and make disciples. We are called to move into particular locations and particular times and invite people into some kind of encounter with this triune God. We are called to baptize into this fullness of God, to bring those we have invited into the fold of God's richness and mercy, and into the family of which we are a part. And we are called to see each other and experience each other as fully baptized people of God, and as fully beloved and fully immersed children of God. And we are also called to teach, to nurture and disciple those who are baptized so that they may grow in faith and love, so that they may grow in their understanding and in their relationship to God. For this is where the fullness of God is expressed, in relationship. In the relationship that God has with each of his constituent parts, and in the relationship that God has with all of his peoples. That is where we most deeply experience the fullness of God, in the context of relationship. And that's why we are called into community and not just floating out on our own and having our primary faith be an expression just between me and God. We are called into wholeness. We are called into community, and we are called to be agents of restoration. And all of this is done under the umbrella of the fullness of God in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Each aspect fully present, fully involved in ways that we can see and experience, but also in ways that are mysterious and beyond our knowing and understanding. In many ways, the Trinity represents the closing promises of our gospel. It gives us the tool to begin to move beyond the me that is our old sinful self, and to begin to grasp the we that leads us into community and that leads us into the world to live and move for the sake of our neighbor. As we are joined into that mysterious community that is the Holy Trinity, and as we live our lives in the bookends of that Trinity, through our baptism we are also joined into the community of believers that is just as wondrous and mysterious. And through the Trinity, we bring with us into the world that same sense of community and mutuality as we speak of the we over the me and live into that model of servanthood and baptismal living that Christ places before us, calls us into, and brings to life in each of us. And so we confess that we believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We confess that by faith, not really understanding or even needing to understand exactly what that means. But we do understand that that blessing, that benediction, gives shape to who we are and how we live, and gives shape and guidance in how we are to love the others that we come across. Amen.
The song of the day is We Believe.
God has made us his people through our baptism into death, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together we confess, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate and was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you. Take a moment wherever you are to greet one another with the peace of Christ.
Peace. Peace, Jonah.
Let us now join in a prayer of thanksgiving for all the good gifts that God gives, which we share. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us now pray for the church, for the world, and for all those who are in need. God of community, you form us as your church. Guide our bishops, pastors, and deacons, and all the baptized into sharing your life-giving good news with all the world. We give you thanks for those who serve at home and far away, lifting up our missionary Courtney Davis and her work in Papua New Guinea, lifting up our companion synods, the Southern Diocese of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Tanzania and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Chile. We pray for our brothers and sisters, the pastors and congregations of the Western Iowa Synod and the whole ELCA. And we ask that you bless your people of every time and every place as they seek to proclaim your presence, your life, and your love. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of creation, you call everything into being. Sustain this world with your renewing word and care. Inspire us to see waterways, plant life, birds, fish, insects, and mammals, and call them good. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of counsel and might, all authority in heaven and on earth belongs to you. Encourage the leaders of this and every land to seek wisdom, peace, and justice. Instill wisdom in all of your children, that we may work toward justice in communities that are often ignored. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of care, you created us in your image, stamped us with your likeness. Help us to see your likeness in one another. Open our eyes to see and attend to all who face oppression and suffering. Console, heal, and nourish all those in need. Especially today we pray for Bob Mortensen Jr., Cindy Peterson, Dwayne Chapul, Catherine Dillon, Linda Jordan, Dean Newland, Larry Chuning, Kyle Anderson, Susan Wheeler, Linda Humble, Phyllis Schroeder, Janice Campbell, Deb Zanfus, Teresa Jensen, Garwin Anderson, Lucille Anderson, and those we now name either aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of companionship, you accompany this body of faith. As the rhythms of summer begin, we ask that you protect all who travel, renew all who will enjoy a time of Sabbath, and shelter all who will not be protected from the sun's heat. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of compassion, you comfort us in the midst of all our sorrows with the promises of the resurrection. We give you thanks for the saints of every time and every place who have enriched our lives and pointed the way to you. Especially today, we give you thanks for the life and witness of Fern Schmidt and Pastor Merlin Norris in and amongst these communities and beyond, asking that you comfort their family and friends as they continue to mourn their passing, and fill us all with a sure and certain hope of life together in your care. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Receive these prayers, O God, those spoken and those that are too deep for words. We lift them up to you through the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our closing hymn is in the green hymnal number 535, Holy God, We Praise Your Name.